May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Good morning, Cathedral family. It was a hot Wednesday afternoon in August. My brother, two sisters, and I were playing in our bedrooms while my parents were sitting on the living room couch watching something on TV. Out of nowhere, with a sense of urgency, my mother called the four of us to come quickly to see what they were watching. We all ran in, not quite knowing what to expect. When we got there, my parents told us to sit down and to watch because history was being made. I was not quite sure what they meant by that, but I followed their instructions and I sat and I watched the history that was being made on the television screen. I remember watching and wondering why so many people were all standing in the hot sun listening to a man give a speech. My then six-year-old mind was not taking in what he was saying. What I was taking in, however, was my parents' reactions to his words. Both were silent and clearly moved by this man's words. Occasionally, one of them would utter, "That's right," or "You tell it." That history-making event will be marked on Tuesday, 2 days from now. For Tuesday will be the 55th year anniversary of the March on Washington, when Martin Luther King Jr. seized the American imagination with his dream for this nation and its people. Now, what I did not realize then was that for my parents, the history being made in that moment in time was actually about their hope that the dream they had for their four children was coming closer to reality on that day. They, too, wanted their four children to live in a world where they, as King said, will not be judged for the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. They, too, wanted, as King dreamed, a world where little black boys and little black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and little white girls as sisters and brothers, and I might add, a world where children of all colors will be able to join hands as family. In that moment, 55 years ago, my parents' hope and King's dream and theirs was for them probably even more poignant than I could have imagined, because they knew that 8 years earlier, on that very day, another mother's dream for her child had come to a tragic end. For it was on August 28, 1955, that Mamie Till's 14-year-old son, Emmett Lewis Till, was lynched for the crime of crossing the racial line of whistling at a white woman. A woman who last year admitted that she had lied and that, in fact, Emmett never committed this so-called breach of racial conduct that served as an excuse for his monstrous murder. And so, why am I talking about all of this on this morning? Why? Because on this one day in history, 2 days from now, August 28th, this one day tells the story of where we are today as a people, as a nation. In his classic 1903 text, The Souls of Black Folk, W.E.B. Du Bois, who, by the way, died on August 27, 1963, just one day before King's speech. In this text, Du Bois speaks of the warring soul of African Americans, at once African, at once an American. Now, this poignant description of a warring soul, in fact, provides an apt description of our nation, not only 55 years ago, but perhaps today. For in the words of Du Bois, we seem to be a nation with two thoughts, two unreconciled strivings, two warring ideas. We have yet to decide if we are going to be a nation and a people defined by Martin Luther King's dream, or a nation and a people defined by Emmett Lewis Till's lynching. The soul of our nation is warring, perhaps with its very self. And so, what does that mean for us as we sit here today as believers in God, as believers in the God of Jesus Christ? Who are we to be in a nation with a warring soul? This question is answered for us most strikingly in the letter from which we read this morning, Paul's letter to the Ephesians. We enter this letter near its conclusion, where Paul is essentially summing up all that has come before in a manner meant to rouse his readers into action. Thus, he uses the imagery of a soldier prepared for war as a way of relaying to his readers the urgency of the situation, that is, the urgency to live out what it means for them to be believers in, indeed followers of, the God of Jesus Christ, especially at a time that wars against the very ways of that God. And most importantly, he uses this imagery to assure them that as believers in God, they are more than equipped, indeed equipped by God, with, as he says, the armor of God, equipped to face whatever battles may come their way, even in a world that seems to war against the very truth, the very righteousness, the very peace that is God's. And so it is, with a sense of urgency and assurance, Paul answers the question of what those who are believers in God are to be in a nation with a warring soul. He answers it with saying something quite simple. He says this: be strong in the strength of God and God's power, and stand firm. Be strong and stand firm in the strength of God. And so, what does that mean? What does it mean to stand strong and to be firm in the strength of God? It means, first and foremost, we are to be, borrowing from a story in the words of Bryan Stevenson in his book, Just Mercy, we are to be stone catchers. Stone catchers. In this world and nation that is ours, stones are constantly being cast. These are stones of bigotry, stones of fear, stones of hatred, stones of intolerance, stones of disdain. To be a people who stand firm as believers in God is not to be a people who cast stones, but rather a people who catch stones. A people who catch the stones that are hurled against the sacred dignity of our very humanity. And so, just how are we to catch these stones? We can catch them by showing up as a witness against them, or by speaking up when they are being thrown in our presence, or by standing with those against whom they are thrown. Cathedral Church, Jesus was a stone catcher. He was a stone catcher for the woman who was attacked for adultery as he turned her attackers away. You who are without sin, he said, cast the first stone. Indeed, his ministry was defined by what it meant to be a stone catcher, for he was a stone catcher for Samaritans, a stone catcher for lepers, for the blind, for the lame, for all those who were marginalized, all those whose sacred humanity was assaulted. And so, what does it mean for us to be believers in the God of Jesus Christ? It means that we are to stand firm in this our stone-throwing world. It means that we are to stand firm as stone catchers. And it means also that we must be opportunistic. We must take advantage of every opportunity to show forth at least a glimpse of the God in whom we believe. Ours is a God who cares about each hair on our very head. Ours is a God with a heart, which is why the best synonym for God is love. And so it is. We must be opportunistic in showing forth the heart of our God in our interactions with all those whom God loves. And that is everyone that has had, that has, or has ever had a strand of hair on their heads, no matter how straight or how curly. Put simply, we must take every opportunity to reach beyond the indecency of our earthly realities toward the decency of God's heart. Truth be told, it is far easier to be kind and loving than it is to be hateful and mean. And so it is that Jesus says, "Because I have loved you, you are to love one another." This is what it means to stand firm. We are to be opportunistic in showing forth the heart of God. And so we must also be unpretending, as in not pretending to be other than we are, creatures of God, which, by the way, is pretty darn good. Bottom line, we are to free ourselves from those pretensions of privilege that are race, that are religion, that are class, that are gender, that are sexual expression, or any other pretended privilege that tells us we are more valuable, more special, more important, more entitled than another human being. And here is the thing. It is in freeing ourselves from the pretensions of our living that we are then best able to take advantage of the opportunities to show forth the heart of God. For in being free from such pretensions, we are truly able to be empathetic, that is, to feel the pain, the heartache, indeed the yearnings of others. Why? Because without the pretensions of privilege, we discover that we are all really the same. We are, as my younger sister likes to say, all just dressed up dirt, with bodies that can be hurt and need care, with hearts that can be shattered and need love, and spirits that can be broken and need mended. And so it is no doubt for this reason that most major religions profess some version of the golden rule as Jesus gives it to us. Do unto others as you would have them to do unto you. And so, yes, to stand firm as believers in the God of Jesus is for us to be unpretentious. And then finally, it is for us to laugh. Yes, laugh like LOL, laugh out loud. For here is the thing. The God in whom we believe is a God who laughs. Indeed, laughs last by triumphing over the culture of evil and death, yet crucified God's very Son. And so it is that God's act of resurrecting Jesus from his crucifying death is nothing less than God's last laugh over the crucifying powers of evil. Ha, 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 gotcha, God says. The resurrection is the laugh of God. For us to stand firm as believers in the God who resurrects is for us to laugh with God by refusing to give in to any crucified realities of this world, which is nothing less than giving up on the resurrecting power of God. And so it is that our faith our faith in the promise of God that one day justice will roll down like water and righteousness as everlasting, ever-living stream for all of God's children. Our faith in God's justice is our life to all that would dare to separate us or anybody else from the truth that is God's. And so, there you have it. Stand firm as believers in God. Be stone catchers, opportunistic, unpretentious, laughing people. And so what? Cathedral Church, we are 2 days away from a day in history that marks the anniversary of Martin Luther King's dream and Emmett Till's death. A day, therefore, that indeed tells us something about the soul of our very nation. There is no getting around it. It is a warring soul. But what about us? What about our souls? As believers in God, as believers in the God of Jesus Christ, our souls should never be at war, for our soul is that which connects us to our very God. And it is for this reason that Paul exhorts us to be strong and stand firm in the strength of God. Stand strong in the soul of who you are. On that history-making day, 55 years ago, Martin Luther King Jr. did just that. He spelled out for the world to see the soul of who he was. For as he stood there at the Lincoln Memorial, he was being nothing less than a stone catcher for the Emmett Tills of this world. He was taking advantage of the opportunity to share his dream. Unpretending as he spoke as the child of God that he was, and laughing with God when he proclaimed that the day would come when all of God's children would be able to proclaim that they are free at last. As it was for King, let it be for us. On Tuesday, August 28th, let us stand firm in the strength of our Lord. Let us stand firm in the center of our soul. Let us commit ourselves in these urgent times when our nation's soul is warring against itself. Let us commit ourselves to being a people with soul, being a people who are stone catchers, opportunistic, unpretending, and sharing a last laugh with God. Amen.